Okay, so thank you. And welcome. Welcome to the first of two launches of the Caregiver edition of the Peregrine Literary Journal this year. And Peregrine is part of the publishing arm of Amherst Writers and Artists. I'm Sue Reynolds, and for the last 4 years, I've been the chair of AWA. And I'm especially delighted to be the host for tonight's event. When we began the Caregiver Project almost 2 years ago, we knew that we wanted to put together an anthology of writing by caregivers. But I was absolutely delighted when AWA decided to devote the 37th edition of this long-standing literary journal to caregiver writing. Not only the writing that had come out of those workshops, but the writing of a wide range of people providing care for loved ones. The pieces in this book are tender, artful, beautifully crafted, and very moving. So, to celebrate the work and the writing of caregivers in this way, we're going to have readings from a number of the contributors tonight. But before we get started, I just want to say a few thank yous. This is an astonishing organization, AWA, started by the vision of our founder, Pat Schneider. Our mission is to support the voices of established and emerging writers. To free silenced and marginalized voices. And I think the voices of caregivers are often marginalized. And to promote respect for the artist and all writers through the use of the AWA method of leading writing workshops. AWA has no formal grants, no funding, and that means it survives and thrives on the work of many, many volunteers devoted to carrying on Pat's work. So just before we get to the readings, I want to give a deep bow of thanks to a few people. The Caregiver Project and the Power Story Committee, members who shared the vision for the caregiver workshops and invented them from the ground up. So, Dr. Meadow Jones, Mary Simmerling, Susan Wingert, Carla Hansen, who's here tonight, Sarah Kerr, Beth Lehman, Francine Diodati, and all the support breakout room facilitators and the participating writers whose enthusiasm for this project let us know we were on the right track. And in the publishing arm, there are a number of heroes. I want to thank Jan Hagg, who pilots this publishing end of the organization with history and with heart. A deep bow of thanks to our prose editors, Janet Summers and Carla Hansen, and to the poetry editors, Ellen Summers, and once again, Jan Hagg. Also, an enormous thank you goes out to Lane Goddard for overseeing the layout, and especially to Elizabeth Perlman, who not only laid out the 200 pages of this journal, but did so from her home in Asheville, North Carolina, in the middle of the hurricane disaster. Elizabeth's last text to us before she lost power was, "Oh my God, I just put the final touches on Peregrine. How am I going to get it to you without power or internet?" So, like, talk about dedication. And also, talking about dedication, my thanks always and forever goes to our managing director, Katie Frank, who's with us tonight and who does more than anyone can possibly imagine to keep this marvelous boat afloat. And finally, thank you to the 75 writers who offered their work for this edition, and especially to the 23 of you who are willing to come and read tonight. I'm so delighted you're here. Okay, so I'm going to read a short bio that has been adapted from the end, the back of Peregrine. We're going to go in last name alphabetical order. And I'm going to try and get your names correct. There's nothing worse than a misspelling or mispronouncing someone's name. And I will just say I'm nervous. So even though I've practiced all of it, I may still screw it up. So please forgive me. So let us begin with Jane Hilson Aiello. She's an intuitive poet living in Colorado who began penning poetry at 8 years of age after hearing her third grade teacher recite the poem Trees by Joyce Kilmer. She left school that day with the purple mimeographed sheet pressed to her nose and had it memorized by the time she'd walked home. Her work has been published in local anthologies. Jane, if you would please read to us.
Thank you, Sue, and thank you to Amherst Writers and Artists, and thank you to the Peregrine Journal. Hands. My hands have held the hands of sick parents, felt the searching grasp of a newborn baby. A single hand was squeezed by fearful patients. My hands embraced my friend's hands as our neighborhood glowed with ember, rained with ash. My hands have prayed for the injured, changed the diaper of an adult, cooked soup for the ailing. My hands have counted out meds, rubbed lotion onto crepe paper skin. My hands have shoveled dirt onto a grave, planted flowers in remembrance, written myriad cards of condolences. My hands have packed up belongings, opened letters from well-wishers. Now I learn my hands are an appendage of my heart, caring hands, loving hands, comforting hands, happy hands that wave and hug and open to the world, hurting hands that have lost their strength, sorrowful hands that cover my eyes in grief.
Jane, thank you so much for that. I've got goosebumps. Thank you. Our next reader is Navneet Buller, who divides her time between Pennsylvania and the Indian Punjab. She's a physician and a climate activist whose poetry and essays have been published in a number of literary journals. She writes basking in her parents' presence and also enjoys arranging flowers for them. Navneet, if you could please raise your hand and then read to us. Thank you. There you are.
Thank you, Sue, Katie, and everyone who's here today. This is a special day. This is the first time a poem of mine has been read after publication. I'm very grateful. Hyphens. If you must know something, know that the hardest thing is to live only once. Ocean Vuong. Limb-heavy daughters disappear into the swirl of their parents' maladies. Unmissed, unsung, they slide with the days. Eat on their feet, shuffle into public causes which aid escape from guarding frail parents. Like day-blind stars, they twinkle in the night in cluttered bedrooms and bathrooms always lit. Staggering at daybreak, tongue tips sore from sleeping, sitting on dipped chins, they look for hyphens in their days, the smiles, and sunny spots. The mother cooks with her one good hand as the daughter fills tap water in the pan and unscrews the spice jar lids. Mom sings a song into the night, which dad sang loud, don't you remember? Her face shrunken over mismatched salwar kameezes. The mother laughs when awakened for dinner. Only a fried egg she wants. She shuffles sleepless, bored, in the half dark. Her offspring sleeps deep on the other side of her double bed. The father 2 years ago called out the sleeping daughter's name, Aja. And they said bluntly, here I am, now what? Instead of a hug to squeeze away his anxiety. Pause. There's just one body. Time can stop. Bathroom, bulb lit, her head lolls over the edge of pillows. Thank you.
Navneet, thank you so much. Our next reader is Anne Clark, a psychotherapist in private practice in Sacramento, California, who writes regularly in an AWA workshop. Anne is working on a memoir centering on her mother's cancer diagnosis and death, and includes other forms of loss, recovery, and growth. Anne, if you'd please read to us.
My mother's husband calls to tell me that mom will receive an emergency tracheostomy. The cancerous tumors are obstructing her ability to breathe. I hang up the phone and sob at the idea of a permanent hole in my mother's neck, of more pain for her. The next day, I walk into the ICU room and see mom, post-surgery, looking scared. With just her wide-eyed expression, I feel her saying, "Can you believe this?" The rubber tube protrudes from her neck. I try to be cheerful, even though it is a horror. My sister Sarah and I sit with mom for hours, our vinyl industrial chairs pulled up close to her hospital bed. Mom wants us to chit-chat, keep her distracted. She writes down questions on her pad of paper. She nods in response to our answers. It is unclear if she will be able to talk again. After a full day with mom, my sister and I leave her to grab dinner. As we exit the hospital, it feels like a miracle to have a healthy body, to walk with ease, breathe fresh air. We sit down at the brightly decorated place, surrounded by people doing normal things, laughing, eating the warm, salty tortilla chips dipped in spicy salsa, drinking beer. My exhausted sister sinks into her chair and says, "This is great." I give her a maniacal smile and say, "It's always a good time when your mom gets trached." She laughs. She's in hysterics. Toward the end of the meal, I say, "I don't know if she'll be here in a year." And then Sarah cries. The next day, we bathe her. Mom sits vulnerable, naked in a plastic shower chair. Sarah stands behind Mom, holding the sprayer. I wash her feet, scrub between each of her toes, then shampoo her hair. We avoid the wound in her neck. Mom will later write on her pad of paper that it wasn't easy having her 75-year-old body on display. To us, it is the absolute most precious thing, caring for her in this way. After the shower, we walk slowly down the hospital hall with her. Mom's middle-aged girls flank her, each holding one of her hands. Back in her room, I say to Mom, "Grandma would hate that you were going through this." Mom writes on the tablet, "I have had the same thought." Mom looks pained, then writes, "I won't be there with you when you die." Such a sweet sentiment. She was with her mother when she died. Mom knows we will be there for her. Of course she wants to be with her children in our moments of suffering, even our own deaths. Then she writes, "You girls are the best of my life." We gaze at each other, the three of us, nodding, drenched in love. Thank you.
I feel drenched in love listening to that. Beautiful. Thank you so much, Anne.
Thank you.
Our next reader is Joanne M. Clarkson, whose sixth poetry collection, Hospice House, was published by Moonpath Press in 2023. Her poems have been published in many literary journals. Clarkson has master's degrees in English and library science, and she taught and worked for many years as a professional librarian. After caring for her mother through a long illness, she re-careered as a hospice RN. Joanne.
Thank you. As a hospice nurse, it often wasn't the medications I brought or the wound care or the special treatments that people appreciated most. It was having an advocate. And that's what this poem is about. And I will probably cry. This was a beautiful experience, ultimately. It's called The Necessary Piece. They didn't have the part, the one small gadget essential to make the broken washer run. And without it, she could not keep him clean. Could not maintain his dignity or the comfort of fresh sheets, soft towels, stain-free baggy flannels, the only clothes he wore now in his hospital bed. The repairman said it would take a week, the final week, to order it. And those words broke her. I had never seen his cancer make her cry. Until that day, the smallest device in the greater machine she had no name for, but failure and a broken promise. Hospice nurse for years, it broke something in me too. I spoke into the phone politely at first, explaining the problem and requesting, if not the part, a replacement washer. Then louder to the supervisor, who recited the same inflexible monotone policy, lending no compassion. Until two management team leaders later, I was screaming, "We don't have a week, and you have the greatest power over the smallest part, inflicting suffering." Maybe the fourth voice also had a loved one who passed. Or maybe she recognized the sound of despair. But within an hour, a new repairman appeared with the necessary apparatus to make the washing machine sing its gruff old tune of tide and bleach, the universal anthem of clean. Thank you.
Oh my goodness. So grateful to hear that story of advocacy, effective advocacy. It's beautiful. Thank you so much, Joanne.
Thank you.
Our next reader is Linda Jackson Collins. She's an editor at the Sacramento Poetry Center's journal Tool Review and is co-publisher of River Rock Books. Her collection, Painting Trees from Random Lane Press, won the gold medal in poetry from Northern California Publishers and Authors in 2019. And she's here tonight to read to us. Linda.
Great. Thank you very much. I'm going to read my poem that's called Forward Light. And I just wanted to point out that it's a golden shovel, which means that the last line or each line ends with a word from the epigraph. So I'll start by reading the epigraph, which is, darkness doesn't war against the light. It comes forward to another light. And the poem's called Forward Light. The phone call comes after darkness settles, when I am alone. It doesn't seem real, this news of my father at war with his own body. I lean my head against the window, and it seems as if the blackness on the other side might break the glass and thicken this light. Many days will pass before we know how it ends, whether the tubes that feed Dad's veins, the one that comes from his mouth, are enough to rally his troops forward. We circle his bed, wondering what to make of his flickering eyelids. Perhaps he sees another kind of window, another kind of light.
Linda, thank you so much. Those flickering eyelids. Beautiful. Our next reader is Pallas Cotter, who provides care for both her mother and her stepfather, each of whom have dementia. Writing helps her manage the sadness of watching them disappear. Her poems and essays have been published in a number of prestigious literary journals. Pallas, if you'd please read to us.
Thank you, Sue, and thank you to this talented cohort. I've been moved, so moved by what you've said. I'm glad I'm going near the top because I'll be in tears by the end. Mine is titled Birdsong. She sits on her balcony. Her eyes search the trees. She is watching, listening for loved ones. I knock on the door, but she can't hear me. She's out there, smiling and singing. I say, hello, see in her eyes a startled look, like she'd almost forgotten. She says she's conversing with the birds. My uncle, my father, my brother. I am fascinated by her new affectations. As she talks, her hands flap and flutter. I hear her murmur, mm-mm, mm-mm, mm-mm. A sing-song sound covering a musical third. Then I hear the birds. Their notes in the tree sound the same with the same inflection. The next time I visit, she complains of a new symptom. She pulls at her sleeve. I feel something itchy. I peek down the back of her blouse and try not to gasp. I see sprouting on her shoulder a single black feather. Long, elegant, and shiny, it's flat against her pale skin. It's just a little, nothing you should worry about. She frowns at me, but says nothing. We sit on the porch together silently. I watch and wait for the day when I step outside to see her perched on the railing, head cocked, mouth open, and hear her mm-mm, 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 answered, and see her spread her wings. Thank you.
My goodness. That amazing moment of magic realism. It's gorgeous. Pallas, thank you so much.
Thank you, Sue.
Our next reader is Karen Fitzgerald, a genre-fluid writer whose poetry, prose, and essays have appeared in a number of literary journals and print anthologies. Karen is steeped in gratitude for The Sitting Room, an archival library whose beneficence provides her a room of one's own to diligently work on her debut novel while surrounded by the works of the most inspiring women in the history of literature. Karen.
Thank you so much. I'm terribly moved by everything I've heard. And as it was said, I'm just privileged to be here. I'm going to read you an excerpt from my story titled, And Then She Winked. The story entails some family dynamics to which I had to apply tough love before my mom was finally placed in a full-scale nursing facility. She'd been there about a year, and then one day she fell. It's my name on the line in case of an emergency call. I got to the hospital before the ambulance. She had to have her forehead stitched. Her ribs were broken. I stayed with her, sat by her bed, holding her hand. Every so often she'd squeeze my hand and look at me with a childlike expression of fear that reduced me to weeping helplessness. Was I aching for her, or was I her aching? After a 10-hour vigil, I was sent home to get sleep. 3 hours later, I got a call and rushed back. Mom's organs were shutting down. The end was near. I stayed with her, silently chanting, God's will be done. Please don't let her have pain, over and over. God's will be done. I've no idea how many hours passed before it happened. I had dozed off, Mom's hand in mine, when I felt her grip, so strong and firm. I bolted awake, and then Mom was upright, eyes wide open, sparkling, darting here and there. She looked right at me and smiled, that radiant smile of a time before the illness had obliterated mind and body, soul and spirit. There she was, right before me, my mom of old. And then she winked. Nothing in my life ever startled me more than that moment of her full-bodied awakening. Before I could apprehend what was going on, she disappeared. Her face went slack, the sparkling eyes dimmed as if her spirit had suddenly vacated her entire body immediately. And she deflated and slumped back into bed, all gone. No, she didn't die. God's will seemed otherwise. She continued in this life another year. Oh, but that moment, the moment of Mom's awakening, it is vividly etched in the scrapbook of my memories, and I nurture it daily. It is a memory that will never age out, as memories are apt to do when one meanders into her elder years. Thank you.
Thank you so much. The vividness of that awakening moment. So powerful. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you.
Our next reader is Daniela. I just want to make sure I articulate that. Daniela Fritter, who's a chemist who works in the consumer products industry in the San Francisco Bay Area. She's working on her first memoir about coming to an understanding of her undiagnosed autistic mother while helping her downsize. Concurrently, she writes narrative poetry about her mother's progress into dementia. Daniela.
Thank you, Sue. Hello, everyone. It's an honor to have my poems appear in this issue alongside everyone else's wonderful pieces. My mother has been in an elder care facility for a little over 2 years now. I visit her once a week, and I've been writing narrative poetry to describe my experience of her progression. The poem I'm going to read takes place early on, about 6 months into her stay in assisted living. At this point, she's already slipping into her native language, which is German, and she's already spending a lot of time in her head back in Germany after World War II. The poem is called The Apple Thief. She walks over to the fruit bowl at the entrance of the dining hall in the assisted living facility. Kathy at the front desk watches her as she takes an apple in each hand. She slips first one, then the other, inside her open jacket, her bent arms stiff against her body, making apple-sized bulges in the crooks of her elbows. Before she walks back to us, she grabs a couple of bananas, one in each hand. "She hasn't eaten," she says to Kathy, pointing a banana at me, arms clamped to her sides. "Oh, okay," says Kathy, smiling and nodding at us. We hurry to the exit with the forbidden fruit. In the car, Mom unloads her booty. "Wie viele Leute kommen zum Essen?" How many people are coming to eat? "Nur ich heute," I tell her, "just me today," although it's always just me. We share one of the bananas after lunch. She leaves the rest of her bounty in my car after I take her back. I don't mention it. There's probably a stash in her room already. I can't very well return them to the fruit bowl. It would be a violation of the hygiene rules. Now I'm stuck with Mom's contraband apples and a stray banana. But I've got it covered. Over the next couple of days, I'll be eating the evidence. Thank you.
Being made an accessory is beautiful. Thank you so much, Daniela. I love the way the mom says she hasn't eaten. Teresa Gaffney is next. Is it Therese or Teresa? Or Terry, maybe, is the way. You are muted.
There we go. It's Terry, but I go by Therese, my real name.
Okay, great.
I'm writing.
All right, since I'm doing the bio, I'll do this formally. Therese Gaffney writes poems that express her delight and sadness in being alive in the 21st century from the viewpoint of an older woman immersed in Western culture. She holds an MFA in creative writing from the University of Idaho. So Terry, please.
Thank you, Sue. And thanks especially to Katie, who reached back out to me today. I appreciate it. And like others have said, I'm so honored to be part of this group. These poems are just amazing, and I know I'm going to be referring back to them in the future. My father's 92 and living alone, stubborn, independent, but needing help. So the poem I'm reading is called Pandemic Haircut. I use the buzzers with the number 3 shield first, start at the base of his neck, glide up to an imaginary line above my father's ears, then flick my wrist, pulling the blades away from his head. Switch to the number 4, take the comb and scissors from the zippered black bag. "There's a spot that's a little too thick," he says, "won't lie flat." I reach for the thinning shears. "Most men," I say, "worry about losing their hair." He looks at me and grins. "I like losing some of my hair every month, just like this." Thank you.
Beautiful. Thank you, Terry. Love the specificity of the actual numbers of the shields. It's gorgeous detail. Thank you. Our next reader is Carol Good. Carol Good has redirected her creativity into writing, mostly poetry, since retiring in 2021. She completed her AWA workshop leader training in July 2019, published her book Alive in 65 in 2021, launched her poetry website, and is a member of the League of Canadian Poets. Carol.
Thank you so much, Sue and Katie and the Peregrine crew. They've done a fabulous job. I'm in awe of the company I'm keeping tonight. I can only imagine that the next launch reading will be equally spectacular. I want to say that this poem was inspired, the one I'm going to share with you today, was inspired by the work my husband and I have been doing for the past year and a half with our son, who's on a recovery journey. So thank you so much for this opportunity. The poem is called Still My Baby. Is this man still my baby, the sought-for son I gratefully grew, then pushed out into the big wide world? Now we are here, an unfamiliar, uncomfortable place where he needs nurturing, yet is too big to be confined and kept safe. This time I need to push harder so he knows, I believe, we are both strong enough for whatever comes. Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Oh, thank you so much. Those two different sessions of pushing. Thank you. Arabella Grayson is going to be our next reader. Arabella is a writer in residence at the Santa Fe Art Institute. Her poetry and short stories have appeared in several literary journals, and she has also read at Stories on Stage. Now she's going to be reading for us. I think, Arabella, are you there? I did see you earlier. I'm going to go on to our next reader, who will be Holly Holt, and we'll check in a couple of readers and see if Arabella's either we've found her or she's found her way back to the room. So Holly, not to put you on the spot suddenly, but Holly Holt is a writer, embodiment guide, and musician who loves funky thrift store finds, collecting rocks and feathers and magic. Currently, she's editing a novel and leading women's writing immersions from her home in Fair Oaks, California. She's an AWA affiliate and instructor, and her writing appears in a number of journals. Have I frozen? Can you hear me okay?
You mm-hmm. frozen?
We okay. can hear you, but your name says Arabella.
Oh, how very odd. Okay.
I'm just going to go ahead and spotlight Holly, and we'll see if she's in motion.
Okay, and I'm going to turn off my video.
Okay. I don't want to be redundant, but I've just been, I really, really feel honored beyond belief that I am included in this anthology. Thank you. This is a poem called 1,000 Arms, One Heart. I make no apologies for how fast I move as I swing my hips, boom, boom, through the room. Mom, stay there, I'll bring it to you. The laundry basket hanging like a hoop. My rage, fierce like Callie. Dad, can't you hear me? I am Athena resetting passwords because Dad can't remember, and Mom always let him do it all. I am Hera, Bridget, Sarasvati, Kuan Yin. I am Baba Yaga and Mary Magdalene. And underneath these hanging breast sacks and three layers of Buddha belly fat, I am Persephone, bride to Hades. She has never left me. Persephone, the good daughter, crawls inside my capillaries. But I am a universe of stars. Now I am the one in charge. So don't tell me not to feel it. This disintegration. Don't tell me not to see it, this death. Don't tell me to apologize for this. The word sorry will never leave my lips. I am the flame and the flood. I am the erratic hum, a forest full of cicadas, the rush of the Columbia River after the snow melts. My mouth, the channel, my ears, the shout, my hips, the way in and the way out. My eyes, the witness, and the tell. My heart, the closing bell. Thank you.
Oh, again, a wash of goosebumps at that rhyming couplet at the end, and all of that goddess energy. So powerful, Holly. Thank you so much. Arabella, we found you, or you found your way back to us or something. I can see that you're there. So we'll go back and you'll be our next reader. Arabella Grayson is a writer in residence at the Santa Fe Art Institute. Her poetry and short stories have appeared in several literary journals, and she has read at Stories on Stage. And now, hopefully, she's going to read to us. We've lost her again. Oh, no. Oh, I think she's really struggling with her internet. I noticed when she and I were struggling for bandwidth there, I had a little yellow internet thing in the corner. We'll hope she makes her way back to us. I'm not going to read her introduction again if she does. And I just wanted to say Barb Hunt was supposed to be with us tonight, but she got stuck in some administrative thing tonight, so she's not going to be with us. And I'm sorry, because Barb is just a beautiful poet. Which brings us to Dana. So Dana Lindell lives in Santa Fe, New Mexico. She works as a program director at Portland State University, has a PhD in education, has published articles, is in a band called Below Canada, cheers from the Canadian team here, and is a caregiver for her father who's living with cancer. She also cared for her mother who died from cancer in 2015. Dana is finishing her first memoir about being an only child caregiver.
Thank you. Let me check here. First, thank you so much. I will add to my bio that my father, who I was caring for, died on October 26th of this year. So these are all especially poignant and raw words. So thank you all. And thank you to Peregrine for listening to caregivers. I know the isolation of it can be strong, and seeing you all makes me feel like I've been part of something huge, for better or worse. So I'm honored. This poem I'm gonna read is a little more abstract, probably because I just don't wanna cry. I've done so much of it. So this particular one is about finding a perfect moment in the midst of the challenges of caregiving when I cared for my parents in Santa Fe, New Mexico. They both had cancer and I lost both of them. This poem is called Momentos Imperfectos, Imperfect Moments. When the familiar curves of a worn-out road carve out jagged potholes after the storm, we learn to step delicately and lean into the remaining treads on our favorite pair of hiking boots. Peligro, danger. When the red snake in the arroyo expects to catch a nutmeg mouse on a sunny afternoon but finds none, it slithers away in disappointment and simply waits and tries again, mañana, tomorrow. When the high desert winds rage in the spring, flinging prickly tumbleweeds across dusty roads, the coyotes, rabbits, and canyon wrens squint, huddle, and build new homes. Resignación, resignation. When the tsunami hits and disturbed, well-laid, fully paid plans, casting the mind's photographs aside, we swim weak laps, flail our arms, and hang on the beams of a waning moon. No milagros, no miracles. When we release our futile grip and gently draw up the brown linen shade, we invite inevitability to color the sill as we sip hot coffee from a persimmon cup together, one unremarkable afternoon. Finalmente, uno momento perfecto. Finally, a perfect moment. Thank you all.
Oh, Dana, beautiful transformation over the course of that poem. Thank you. Thank you so much. Is Jennifer Markle here? I didn't hear back from Jennifer when I was...
I'm here.
Yes? Okay, yes. Can you
pop up
your hand so we can find you? And I'll read your introduction.
Okay.
Jennifer Markle's poetry collection, Samsara, was named a must read by the Massachusetts Book Awards. Her poems are published in a wide range of literary journals.
Okay, thank you. And what a wonderful array of poems. This is really quite something.
This is a prose poem. Carlene informs the new home health aide. It's not a sleepy job, it's a pee-pee job. You take Mrs. Wood to the bathroom when she rings the bell. She rings a lot. Cook eggs her way, soft boiled, 6 minutes. Set the timer, she listens for the buzzer. Give her some conversation when she eats. It puts her in a better mood. Say something personal. Tell how your husband likes his eggs runny, your mother dry. Something she likes to hear is, when it comes to eggs, everybody has their own way. If she's in a good mood, you can say more. Today I tell her, my son was asleep on the couch when I left this morning. He was wearing the gold cross I got him for Christmas. Lunch is 12:30. Tuna salad on soft wheat, pickle on the side. Cut the sandwich into two triangles. She starts from the corner and works her way in. You can't go wrong with chicken breast for dinner. Make sure she never runs out of clean peaches. Don't use the cloth napkins. Stay away from her closet. She'll think you're going to steal her shoes. It helps to do your makeup. Cherry lips, pink up your cheeks. No matter Mrs. Wood's nearly blind. If you're lucky, on your break, you'll see handsome Ronnie sweeping the hallway. When he smiles, you see the space between his front teeth, wide like the hours. Some days are so long, when I take Mrs. Wood to the bathroom, I check the mirror to make sure I'm still here. Thank you.
Oh, Jennifer, thank you so much. My goodness, the tiny details from the different kinds of eggs to the eating away in from the corner. It's gorgeous. Thank you so much. I believe that Arabella has solved her tech problems and is back with us. So, Katie, can we spotlight Arabella? Yay!
Hi, I'm glad to be back.
Glad to have you back. I've done your bio
Thank
twice,
you.
So I'm just going to say, please read Arabella. We're anxious to hear it.
Okay. Thank you for this wonderful opportunity. My poem is in a letter form, and it's a futuristic take. It's a letter from the mother when the caregiver is not up to the task. Summer solstice 2050. Regarding notice to vacate. Dear Homo Earthus Interruptus, aliases he, I, Homo sapiens, humankind, humanity. As stated in our Genesis notice, your lease has expired. You were forewarned millennia ago. To date, you have violated all terms of the agreement. Therefore, due to ongoing unaddressed problems and your failure to comply, you have forfeited all claims to redress. Urgent eviction notice. This serves as your final warning. You have not been a good steward of my property. You have broken the lease agreement without pause. Due to your neglect and degradation, the landscape is unrecognizable, barren. The oceans polluted and uninhabitable, entire species extinct. And the air unbreathable for all remaining earthlings. Ecological collapse is imminent. All systems need recalibration, thorough cleansing, water, earth, air, and outer space, and repopulating. The lack of upkeep is no longer tenable. This serves as your official notice to vacate. The property will be reclaimed and totally renovated. Your tenancy is terminated without further delay. We will not be providing a reference nor returning your security deposit, which does nothing to mitigate the cost of damages you have incurred to once pristine property during your occupancy. Do not attempt to contact us again regarding this urgent matter. The sun is on standby for further directives. With an abundance of caution, Mother Nature, care of Father Time. Blind CC, Earth Moon, AKA Lunar Landing Space Station 7, Mars, Venus. Thank you.
Oh my goodness, Arabella, thank you so much. When caregiving goes wrong. I also love how that switch, you know, that kind of hermit crab poem adopting the idea of a rental breaking notice adds some humor into a really, really dire situation. Gorgeous work. Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Thank you for letting me share it.
Yeah, I think I'm glad you did. Thank you. Our next reader will be Melanie McGee, who has a master's degree in creative nonfiction and is pursuing an MFA at Wilkes University. She writes about family and faith and is revising a memoir and essays and lives in Columbia, South Carolina. Melanie, are you here? Can you pop your hand up if you are? So I don't know. I didn't actually see Melanie earlier, though she did say she was going to be able to come. I'm going to hope that we haven't lost her. But we'll go on to the next reader, and I'm sure, Katie, you'll be keeping your eye open for her coming back in. So our next reader is Dolly. Dolly Reisman, who lives in the neighborhood of Wychwood Park in Toronto. Her short stories and an excerpt from her novel have been published in various literary journals. She's currently working on a novel based on her short story, The Father King, which was a runner-up in the 2019 Little Bird Short Story Contest. Dolly, over to you.
Hi, everybody. I'm humbled to be part of this anthology. Thank you so much. And a special thanks to Carla Hansen and Sue Reynolds for some editorial advice. This is called Living in Desire. When my partner got sick, I found a lot of rage. I wanted the rights to have rights. I had no rights, but was tasked to care for you when you refused to take care for yourself. I had no rights, but was compelled to bear witness as your brilliant mind splintered and you spoke gibberish and a complicated math problem with no solution. I had no rights as I watched you go rigid with seizures. I had no rights as I watched the docs slip a breathing tube down your throat. I wanted the right to look away. I had to be your decision maker, burdened by our murky relationship. I had to decide on treatments and tests, MRIs, CT scans, and surgery. I had to be interrogated over and over by doctors and nurses. Who are you to him? What right do you have to speak for him? I wanted the right to say, I'm nobody to you. I had to be upbeat, assuring your family you would make a full recovery. I had to recognize your kids and your sisters and take their needs into account as you lay there, tubes and coils mapped onto your body, a ventilator inflating your lungs. I had to interpret for you, telling your doctors you were communicating with them, reaching out, trying to connect when they thought you were getting worse and dying. I wanted the right to bow out. I had to eat that bland, tasteless hospital food if I ate at all. I had to intuit your wishes even when they went against my own. I had to rein in my rage at you for getting sick, for almost dying in front of me. I had to wonder what your life would be like if you didn't come out whole. I don't want those images in my brain anymore, but they are scorched into my memory. I want the right to forget you. Thank you.
Dolly, thank you so much. Wow. What stays with me from that is the incredible pressure in that situation. Thank you. Peggy Schimmelman is our next reader and is also the Poet Laureate of Livermore, California. Her published work includes both poetry chapbooks and novels. She's also co-author of Long Stories Short and Two Truths and a Lie. Her poetry and short fiction have appeared in many publications. And Peggy, over to you.
Thank you, Sue. I'm honored to be here, and I'm really impressed with all the diversity of writing and all the emotion. I tend to get emotional when I read poems about my sister and my family, so bear with me. I'm happy to see other people reacting the same way, so I'm in good company here. my sister, my family grew up, we grew up in Missouri, and I live in California now. So I went back to Missouri to visit my sister shortly before she died from cancer a couple years ago. And this was written then during that visit. In the land of happy endings. You binge watch Mayberry RFD, the Andy Griffith Marathon, wrapped in a quilt on your recliner. I perspire and fidget on the sofa, holding back questions I've carried halfway across the country. Do you fret about what's next? Have you forgiven those who wronged you? Did you know, little sister, that as a child I envied you? The sunny cotton top they called Busy Bee, scrambling up trees and straddling fences, inventor of games and paper doll antics, always on the move, always laughing. Even now, while the ruthless cancer stalks the few healthy cells that remain, you're laughing. I want to ask, how is it that you can still laugh? As Barney and Andy swap cornball humor, Aunt Bee serves up coffee and pie, folksy advice and unconditional love. The episode ends. Before I can speak, you grin and say, let's watch another. And who am I to wrestle you away from this rural utopia where the only illness is a nasty head cold or a toothache? No funerals to plan, no devastating divorces, where homegrown wisdom dissolves all dilemmas, so that at the end of the day, everyone goes home happy. For a bittersweet moment, I savor your smile. Then I hurry to the kitchen to fetch sweet iced tea and crackers. Thank you.
Beautiful, Peggy. Thank you so much. Thank you for that intimate time together. I'm just going to check. Melanie McGee, any sign of her, Katie?
Not that I can see. Thank you for checking.
Okay. Thank you so much. Thanks for tracking. Our next reader then will be Linda Tennyson, who writes poetry and short stories often rooted in nature and finds herself inspired by daily walks in her local park, as well as California's Sierra Nevada mountains and many deserts. Linda lives in Sacramento, California, with her husband and her dog, Lucy. I think you're muted. There we go.
I don't mind being redundant. I'm very proud and honored to be among all this awash and all these beautiful words. I wrote this poem when I visited my sister in Georgia after the death of her husband. She was pretty numb after the experience. I wrote these words to help comfort her and myself. And I felt this was stronger in the first person. After the death of her husband, I've lost weight from my frame. My neck is wrinkled because I carry the force of impossible consequences. How heavy the burden is on my shoulders to lift myself from the warm waters of we and us and sink into the cold currents of me. You stayed alive as you said you would until our anniversary, suffering the tortures of pain and the blessed fog of narcotics. I crave to carry your pain, to make it mine for a day, but I knew it would be too heavy for me. As I swam naked through the blue-green pools of living, you died in the hospice bed. Your ghost and owl swooping past me in the dark woods behind our house to sit on an old oak tree, watching. Why did you have to leave so soon? I want the grief of you to fly away. You left me afloat, struggling to inhale. My legs are heavy as I climb the steps to the house. I look back at our life together. The breath of you fills my lungs as I surface.
Oh my goodness. Linda, thank you so much. Gorgeous imagery and such a powerful mood to all of those images, kind of submerging and arising. Thank you. Kathy Warner will be our penultimate reader. Kathy is the author of 3 volumes of poetry and the editor of 3 poetry anthologies. She lives along the shore of the Hood Canal in the Washington state, where she writes, photographs landscapes and the night sky, and renovates homes. Kathy.
Thank you. It's a privilege to be here among you. This poem is titled The Shed in February, Georgetown, California, 2023. Inside metal walls of the catch-all, hulking at the back corner of my parents' property, ants have nested in styrofoam packaging, grinding protective padding into fine white powder that infiltrates every box and tool, every excess piece of furniture stacked and landfill spared, as if the colony has been sloppily snorting cocaine for years on end. Moldered cardboard and mouse droppings litter narrow spaces where I wedge toe holds on the crowded floor, piling more parental possessions atop the wreckage. In the house, pointing to a walker, a wheelchair, and a commode my recently stroked stepfather needs but refuses to use, my mother waves a hand, says these two can be delivered to the shed she calls utility, but which I mishear as futility. For the first time in weeks that have been weighted by wet snow and my stepfather's death grip on my mother's arm as she navigates him to the toilet, tears drip down our cheeks and our teeth flash white across stress-clamped faces as laughter breaks us open, tendrils reaching from the dark toward unseen sun, trusting in the spring yet to arrive. Thank you.
Oh, that's gorgeous. Thank you so much, Kathy. Those ants snorting cocaine are gonna stay with me. And our final reader for tonight is Elizabeth S. Wolfe. Elizabeth has published 5 books of poetry, and her chapbook, Did You Know?, won a 2018 Rattle Chapbook Prize. In 2023, Elizabeth taped readings at the White House, the Supreme Court, and the U.S. Capitol as part of the Scheherazade Project. Her poetry appears in many journals and anthologies and is archived on the moon as part of the Lunar Codex. Elizabeth.
Thank you. And I knew I was going to be last tonight, which was great because I got to actually listen to everybody. So thank you for putting out the call for this. And I thank everybody for reading tonight. It was a really powerful night. And I'm going to read a poem I wrote for my mother. My mother had severe progressive MS. She died 20 years ago this April. And this is describing a scene from earlier when she had experimental chemotherapy and was completely wiped out from the experience. She spent 3 months in the hospital. The tired woman napped on the table. I thought she was dead. I'd spent the past week getting my mother discharged from the hospital, staying with her at her condo, trying to line up services and home visits and aides, all of which had weeks-long wait lists, which the social services lady must have known about, but I blissfully had not. Still, I tried to herd shreds and feathers of hope. So when I got overwhelmed, I took a short walk to watch ducks at a pond. I came back to see my mother had pulled her scooter up to the antique maple dining room table, rested her head on her numb, swollen hands, and passed out. Her face was gray in sleep, or was it always like that now? And I felt a spasm of guilt that I hadn't been there to make her more comfortable. then a sliver of fear that she was gone, had slipped away while I stepped out. "Ma?" I asked quietly, and then slightly more urgently, "Ma, you okay?" She startled awake. In her younger, sturdier days, she would have been mortified by a strand of drool. "What's the matter?" she asked. "You look like you've seen a ghost." I didn't answer right away. I still wasn't sure that I hadn't. She started to laugh, but tears were trickling down her cheeks, and she couldn't reach the tissues. Thank you.
Elizabeth, thank you so much. Wow. Wow. Amazing. Just amazing voices, amazing pieces. Katie, I'm wondering, would you mind not spotlighting me anymore so I can see everybody all together? So we can all see everybody all together? There we go. Thank you all so much. Thank you for coming to read. I'm feeling like really filled up and wrung out at the same time. I'm just so delighted to have been here. So honored and lucky to have heard so much love in these pieces and so much of the grief and the resilience of being human. I feel so honored and delighted to have been present to hear these intimate words in the voices that created them. And I just want to say that there is a second launch on Sunday afternoon if you're interested in having this done to you again. If you think you could survive another one, I will be there. It's at 2:00 Eastern time, in the same room, I think. You can sign up at the same link that I sent out to sign up for this one.
I just put it in the chat as well, the link to that Sunday event.
Brilliant, Katie. Thank you so much for doing that. And that's it for our readings tonight. Thank you so much, everybody, for all you gave in your words, both on the page and in person. Thank you, Katie, for tech mastering this so beautifully tonight.
Thanks to everyone who raised hands and made it so easy on me.
Great. Yeah, look at all that love.
And thank you, Sue, for your masterful emceeing.
My very, very great pleasure. I know this is what happens in the caregiver workshops, too. We don't want to go home. We just want to stay together.
Will we have access to the recording?
Yes. I will send it out after this. And if people are open to it, in the past, we've put our Peregrine launch readings up on YouTube so that they're available kind of in perpetuity. So I'll do that unless anyone raises an issue.
Thank you.
And it just occurred to me, I'm thinking maybe we'll add you to the caregivers list to let you know about when we're doing the caregiver writing workshops. Would that be okay? And then just delete yourself from the list if you don't want to be notified.
Yes, please. Thank you.
Okay, wonderful.
Thank you, everybody. That was wonderful.
Thanks, everybody. Yeah. That was amazing.
Thanks. Good night.
Good night. Thank you so much.
Thanks,
everyone.
Good night.
Good night.